We learned what kind of techniques we can use to deal with overfitting in this module, and let's in this lesson see how we can implement those in Python and also Keras. The first one was regularization, right? We learned about L1, L2, and dropout regularization. It is fairly simple to implement these. Basically, while we're creating our model, while we're creating the architecture of the model, all you have to do to use regularization is add that as kernel regularization. So if you want to use L1 or L2, what you can do is when you are creating your layer, in the layers that you want to use regularization, just add that as a parameter to the line where you're creating this layer. There are two options to do that. One of them is to just pass it with this string identifier of the regularization. If you do this, you're going to be using the default value for the alpha parameter that we talked about in the lesson. One other thing you can do is to call the function that creates the kernel initializer. In that case, you can specify your own alpha parameter here. You can also, of course, do this separately. So for example, if you are going to use the same initializer all the time, let's say initializer, you can call it that way and then create it this way and also only call the initializer here, for example. That's also one way to do it. One nice thing about Keras is if you want to use L1 and L2 regularizer together, you can just call Keras regularizers L1 underscore L2. It gives you the chance to also specify their alpha parameters separately. So you have that chance if you'd like to do that. The next one is the dropout regularization. That one is fairly simple. You just basically create an extra layer after the layer that you want it to affect, called dropout, just the name of the layer, and then it will create dropout regularization layer for you. Next one we want to look into is data augmentation. As we talked about in the lesson, data augmentation is basically creating variations of your data. This could be rotating it, changing its color based on whatever you want your model to be tolerant about. It's very simple with Keras, actually. Here I'm just importing some libraries, reading a dataset. I'm reading the CIFAR-10 dataset. It has colored images of different things, animals, things, and items, basically. Here, what we do to create transformations is using pre-processing layers from Keras. So if you want a comprehensive list of what these things are, you can go to this link in the notebook. If I want to just do a flip and a rotation, flip is basically either flipping it horizontally or vertically, and rotation is just basically rotating an image. So what I do is I create sort of a model, a sequential model from Keras that has these two layers that first randomly flips the image and then does some rotation to it. And I just get one image from the dataset that I read and apply this model to it 9 times. And here are the resulting photos. Basically, the image, this is like a small image of a horse, and it is either flipped or rotated in different ways. And if you want to use this in a model, what you do is when you are creating your model, you just add this data augmentation, kind of like a thing to be done to your data before it is fed to the actual model, the dense layers and everything, the actual neural network. You just add it as the first layer in your model, and then you can add the rest of your model. One other thing you can do is to use TensorFlow image processing functions. Here, this is just a function for me to be able to show the images and the differences. The left side is original image and the right side is the image after we've done some processing to it. So basically, there are a bunch of different things you can do with the TensorFlow image functions. You can flip it from left to right. You can change the color grading of the image. You can change, increase or decrease the saturation or the brightness. You can do a little crop if you need to. You can rotate it if you need to. And you can also randomize most of these things. If you want more information about this specific TensorFlow functions, you can go to this link here also. I added them here. It gives you like a little nice tutorial to follow if you really want to do data augmentation, if that's something you really need. But in the first step, I think the Keras pre-processing layers should be enough for us to achieve data augmentation in the first place. The last thing that we want to look into is early stopping. As we said, early stopping is one way to stop overfitting. Even though it's not highly recommended, we still want to know how to do it, right? So that we're aware of the possibilities. So here I'm just creating a normal model like we did before in our exercise, read and normalize the data, and then we create our model, and then we can compile the model. And the next thing, the last thing that we need to do is to fit the model to the data, right? And here is where we're doing it. We passed to the model the training, the X values, the input values from the training data, and the Y values. We specify the epochs, the validation data, batch size, and everything. But then you see there is one addition here, and that is the early stopping. So there's a really, of course, you can, if you want to, you can do early stopping manually. You can train your model for a lot of epochs and then go check out the graph and say, hey, it looks like I needed to stop here, and then, you know, re-specify the epochs to be whatever the you started seeing overfitting, and then rerun your model. But you can also do it automatically in a little bit more of a sophisticated way. Then you need to create a callback function from Keras that it already has, which is the early stopping callback function, and then pass this callback function to the fit function of your model as a list in the callbacks section. And there are basically a bunch of things that you can specify here. If you want to see what all of these things mean, you can go to the documentation and see how you should specify them. But just to quickly go over it, monitor means that to decide if I should stop early or not, this is the metric that I'm going to look into. Minimum here, the mode, minimum means we are trying to minimize this metric that we're monitoring, because this is the loss. If that was accuracy, for example, then we would be trying to maximize it so that your model knows what you're looking for. Minimum delta is the minimum amount for which I want the validation loss to change. And if it doesn't change for 5 steps, then your model is stopped, basically early stopped. So what happens is basically you're saying, okay, my patience is 5, minimum delta is 0.05. I'm looking at the validation loss and I'm trying to minimize it. What this early stopping system does is it comes here, finds the validation loss, right? And then it follows the validation loss and it looks at which point your validation stopped decreasing for more than 0.05. And it sees, it basically stops counting from that point on. And then after 5 steps, if it still hasn't decreased for more than 0.05, it says, okay, that's it. I'm going to take this last point where I stopped decreasing for more than 0.05, and I'm going to return the model that gave you that we had at that point. It's quite easy. This is how you set up the early stopping too. And these are basically the things that we learned on how to deal with overfitting. I hope it was clear. If there are any questions, definitely comment them under this video, and I'll do my best to reply to them really fast.